My name is Rainer Grimm. I'm a software developer since 1999. Since 2016, I only do the stuff I love, meaning teaching C++ and also a little bit of Python. Okay, I want to talk today a little bit about the past and a lot about the future. Okay, let's start. Here, that's the past and that's the future. 2017, of course, is the past, but the problem is even GCC, neither GCC nor Clang implemented the parallel STL. So it's also a kind of the future. Only Microsoft did maybe 50% of that. Okay, I will talk about this stuff, and I will talk about this stuff, which is, of course, the future. We have executors. I assume we will get them with 2020, so in a few years. Executor is a concept of executing something. Then we will get improved threads called G-threads. You know, we have smart pointers. With 2020, they should become thread safe. Okay, what else do we have? Stud future. There's a long, long history to stud future, and at least two additional additions are made since 2011. Latches and barriers, I assume we will get them with C++ 20. And to coroutines, I'm not so sure. And in particular, to transactional memory and task blocks, I'm not so sure if they will be part of 20 or maybe of 23. But we will see. Okay, let's start with the past. We have a parallel STL. Oh, it's a little bit, it works. Meaning, you can execute an algorithm of the standard template library by providing a so-called execution policy. Sequential, parallel and vectorized. What does parallel and vectorized mean? It means SIMD, single instruction, multiple data. Here a simple example. Look at this loop, and that is the way you would do it traditionally. You iterate 8 times and you add 5 to vector and store it on REST. That's kind of normal. If your compiler supports special instruction, which can be vectorized, these special instructions are called SSE or IVX. You can do it with 4 ints in one step, meaning you have here an instruction which did it in parallel, so calculate the stuff in parallel. That is vectorized. Okay, how does it look like? A little bit strange. You have to imagine what's on the left. Thanks. That's your job. Always say what's missing. Would be nice. Okay, using namespace, we have a vector with a few elements, and that's the way we would sort this vector with C++ 98. An begin iterator, an end iterator, quite usual. With C++ 17, we can specify this execution policy. Here it will be done sequential, parallel, and vectorized. That's the idea. Okay, read extremely careful. 69 of these algorithms are black, and they are should be available in a parallel or parallel vectorized version. And 8 of them are new, and these are the red ones. They should be, they are meant to run in parallel. As Ivan said it, I will repeat it once more, we will get a transform reduce. If you know, in the functional world, there's a famous function called map. In C++, we are special, we call that transform. So what is here called transform reduce could also be called map reduce. And that is the idea of the big map reduce framework of Google used in C++. That's the usage of transform reduce. Looks a little bit scary, but it's not so difficult. Have a look. It's a vector of strings, and I want to calculate the sum of all length of the strings. Okay, in the first step, I have a begin and end iterator here, and I transform string to its length. Easy. In the second step, that's the reduce phase, I calculate the sum, and that's my starting, my initial value. At the end, I got 21, and maybe it is done in parallel, but forget about this example. But that is the idea of transform reduce. Okay, that's new with C++17. With this parallel STL, it's quite difficult to shoot yourself in the foot, but it's still possible. Have a look here. I'm totally curious about sort. How often is my predicate applied here? I'm totally curious. So what I do is I have a global variable numCount. In each time I apply my predicate, I increment the value by one because I want to know how often I actually apply my predicate. But as you know, global variable, shared state, mutable, meaning data race, meaning undefined behavior, meaning catch fire semantic. Your PC can catch fire, forget the program. At least it should be atomic. Okay, that was the past, now to the future. First to executors. Okay, what's the executor? It's a kind of a basic building block, such as an allocator, something which should execute. The concept of execute is totally general, you know? You want to execute a thread, an algorithm, a coroutine, a task, and you know. So you want to make a basic building block, which is executor. It's similar to an allocator. Okay, and there are a few aspects which are interesting about executors. Have a look here. You can specify where it should run on an internal or external processor. You want to specify if it should run now, eager, or later, lazy, or maybe on a GPU or a CPU. That's the stuff you want to have as a component. Okay, how does it look like? Here I have an executor, and now you see I invoke std async, which is a promise, and I say, do it on my executor. Whatever that means. Could be a thread pool, could be a GPU, could be a strand, could be done sequential, could be. Okay. And here the second case, which is quite nice, I say std for each is an algorithm of the standard template library, and I say execute it parallel, but on my executor. You can combine this stuff, which makes it quite nice to deal with. Okay. And how to, one way, for example, to get an executor is to ask for a thread pool of length 4, and then you just do it on 4 threads. Okay. And that looks a little bit scary, but it's quite easy. Each executor has execution function. In this execution function, you should categorize by two properties, cardinality and direction. Cardinality means it can run on one thread, on one execution agent, or on many bulk. Direction means it could be in one way, two way, or then execution function. One way means it's a kind of fire and forget job. You just start something and you are not interested in the result. Then two way means you want to have the result back, so forward, backward, and then means a kind of a continuation. And these are the ways you can apply or use your executors with these execution functions. Okay. Now to the next topic. To be honest, I was 4 weeks ago at the CPPCon, and Nikolai Sutis asked me, Rainer, what do you think about G-Thread? And I just said to him, what is a G-thread? Now I know it. A G-thread is a kind of improved thread. An improved thread which has two additional possibilities. First, it joins automatically in the destructor. Second, it can be interrupted. Okay, have a look. Do you know what's the nice story about the classical stutz thread is? If you invoke a stutz thread or you create a child and you forget to join it, meaning to forget to call join or detach, it will call a stutz terminate in the destructor, meaning you would get this nice message which says nothing to me. And that would not happen with a, wait a second, here, thread. G thread. That would not happen with a G thread because the G thread joins automatically in the destructor if the thread is still joinable. You see, I ask here, joinable, and I got the answer true. And now you see, it looks nice. So it automatically joins. Second point, the first name of G thread was not G thread, it was E thread. Why? Because it should be interruptible. Now it's joinable. Okay, have a look. A G-thread can be interrupted. The interface is quite simple. In a G-thread, you can accept a so-called E-token, and to this E-token, you can send an interrupt. And then the G-thread can react or not react to this interrupt. That is cooperatively interruption. Also, the weight variance of the conditional variables got additional overloads for dealing with interruptions. And to interrupt it, you just invoke the function interrupt on the G-thread, which will go to the I-token. Now you are curious, that's the way it looks like. Oh, nearly the way. That is called G-thread here. In counter, the same here. And here I created a thread and started it immediately without the possible to be interrupted. But here, that's the difference. See, I used an interrupt token here, and here I ask if I was interrupted. And now the key point. Here I say interrupt. The one which is non-interruptible because there's no E token involved, and the one which is interruptible. And if you calculate extremely careful, 1 second, I sleep each time for a fifth of a second, and I iterate 10 times. That's the output. Interruptible, non-interruptible. And here I said, interrupt me, and only the non-interruptible will continue to run. Why? I forget to mention it. Wait a second. I just said here return, in case an interrupt happens. So the point is, it's cooperatively. You cannot interrupt a thread. You can only say, I want to interrupt you. Because interrupting a thread is a terrible idea. Okay, let's continue. Atomic smart pointers. Okay, we have shared pointers or smart pointers C++ 11, and the rule is quite simple. You should use them. Okay, now we have a problem. We have multi-threading. And is a shared pointer thread safe? Yes, no? Sort of, it's not so easy. The control block is thread safe, and you have the guarantee that it only will be destroyed once, but not the resource, so sort of. And you know what's bad about sharing state in multi-threading? My favorite count from Tony van Aert. Forget what you learned in kindergarten. Don't share. You should not share if you do multi-threading. And a shared pointer is per se shared, so that's the name of it. So it's a bad idea. Okay, now we got an atomic shared pointer and atomic weak pointer, which are atomic, so the resource is also thread safe. Okay. Why do we get this? Out of three reasons. First, the shared pointer, maybe you don't know it, the shared pointer has is special in some case. The shared pointer is, in C++ 11, the only non-atomic type which you can use in atomic operation. That's bad because it's asymmetric, but it's, have a look here. That is possible. I can use atomic store on a shared pointer. That's 11. But that is bad, that's inconsistent. Next reason for having an own type is correctness. If you use a shared pointer, it's quite easy to do this stuff, and then you have a data race, which makes a lot of fun. You know, catch fire semantic. And the third point is, you could also make the shared pointer to atomic, but now you would optimize for the not so common case, which is also a bad idea. At the end, we got a new data type, which is atomic shared pointer, atomic weak pointer. And here's a screenshot from Herb Sutter, from the official proposal. He only shows what is necessary in C++ 11 or in C++ 20 to make this code lock-free. That is a stack, concurrent stack, which is lock-free. And for example here, that is the stuff you have to do in C++ 20, if you would have atomic shared pointer, and that's the way you would do it with C++ 11 to make this stuff thread safe, even lock-free, which is great. And you see, there are a lot of ways to shoot yourself in the foot with 11, but not with 20. Okay, I assume we will get partial specialization or full specialization for std atomic shared pointer, std atomic weak pointer, and these are the official names. I'm not so sure. Something like that. Okay. Oh, now to a strange story. We have futures. There's a lot of discussion to futures, and I assume that is not the end point of the discussion. I assume this discussion will at least continue until 2023. I assume it. Okay. std future is a great feature, promise and promise are a great feature, but they have a few not so great features. In particular, it's not easy to compose them, or to be more honest, it's not possible to compose them, and that's the main drawback. And so what was the first idea? We will improve them. We will support the dot then operation. If this future is done, let this future run. We will support the when any operation. When any of the futures are done, let this future run. We will support the when all operation. When all of the operations or futures, to be specific, when all of the futures are done, let this future run. Okay, is the syntax nice? Maybe not so nice. And that was maybe a reason for the next discussion. At least we can compose them. Maybe you get that, but that looks a little bit more weird. Two futures, when all, two ranges of futures, then this one is ready, then I can go for the next one. And when any looks even weirder, you have to know which one is ready, and the syntax is not so nice. Okay. There was a lot of discussion, and I got an email from one which actually wrote a new proposal for std future, and the second contrahent which kicked in was the topic about the executors, because executors should also be sometimes integrated into the futures. There was a lot of discussion. Okay, first, future and promise are coupled to std thread. Maybe you want to execute it on GPU, what else? You don't want to fix them to a std thread, so it's not so good idea. Now we have executors. The next point is, where should the continuation run? On the promise, on the future, or on a different thread? So a lot of discussion. Next point, this syntax is really, really ugly for continuation. What you want to have is this thread stuff. Just say what you want to apply, not specifying a future. Okay. The same here. I want to invoke f with these three values, but I don't want to say a.get for asking the future for my value, or the promise, to be more specific. I want to just say a and C, and then. So the syntax is quite ugly, and that was a point of the discussion. And there was an additional point. Future blocks in its destructor, and that is all, this is not what you want to have in case of concurrency. So a lot of problems with std future, and I assume that's not the end of the story. Okay, what do we have? Latches and barriers. Latches and barriers, I assume they will be part of C++ 20. Latches and barriers are kind of semaphores. A ledge and a barrier are quite a simple concept. You have a counter. Each thread counts down by one. If the counter becomes zero, all can continue to work. That's a kind of a barrier. We have them in three flavors: ledge, flex, and flex barriers. That's the simplest one: ledge, count down and wait. Count down. You can ask if the counter is zero until just wait. Okay, a ledge is a one-way tool, meaning you can only count down and that was it. But a barrier can be reused. So it counts down to zero and you can use the old counter once more and can do it a few times. And the most flexible is the flex barrier. What a flex barrier can do is, a flex barrier can, wait a second, I have to start differently. When you create a flex barrier, you can invoke it with a so-called callable, something which is kind of a function, okay? This function should return a natural number, minus one, zero, or bigger. And it means when all flex barriers are done, meaning the counter is zero, this function is invoked, and the return value specifies the value of the counter for the next iteration. Minus one means keep the same. Zero, one, know what it means. So you can specify a function which is invoked, which sets the counter for the next iteration. Okay, that was a lot of theory. Here's a small example with a ledge. I have here a thread pool, kind of. Then that is my counter. Okay. I'm the creator. Now I create, have a look, number task threads, maybe 10. Each thread counts down by one, okay? And I, as a creator, have to wait until this counter becomes zero. That's a synchronization point. And that is a ledge which you can only use once. So the creator has to wait until its childs are done. Okay. Coroutines. Okay. Coroutines are a great feature. With what? Okay. Okay, I see. Wait, I have an excuse. That is from the proposal. I just copy it. Yeah, maybe you are right, but address another person. Sorry. I will continue. Okay. But that is the general idea. Count down, wait, and then continue. Coroutines. Oh, we talked a little bit about coroutines. Ivan and all the a lot of talkers before. Coroutines are quite of a nice feature for doing such as cooperative tasks, event-driven systems such as event loops, such as GUIs, such as servers, event-driven systems. You can also use it to create infinite data streams or pipelining. Quite a nice feature. Okay. Only to compare it, to invoke a coroutine, it looks the same, no difference. But if you use coreturn, coawait, or coyield inside a function, it automatically becomes a coroutine. I have to say once, I forget to say the essential part, a coroutine is a function which can be suspended and resumed. So pause. Okay. This becomes a coroutine. That's the handle to the coroutine. Okay. Here's a simple example for a coroutine, which is a kind of a generator. This function can produce an infinite data stream. Okay. Have a look. You see, no end condition here. But here the key point is this co-yield. That's not a return. That means if I invoke it here, I will get back a generator of int. In this generator of int, I can trigger. Each time I trigger it, it will continue, stop here, and return me the new value. So I trigger it, I get first time E, the second time E plus inc, and so on. So suspend, resume. And if I do it only a finite number of steps, I'm totally fine. But if I'm a little bit too eager, of course, it will take a few minutes to get all natural numbers. I have to interrupt it. Okay. This is also a coroutine which looks a little bit more involved. Oh, look at the right side. And forget the red part. That is a kind of a server, typical server. I have a while loop. Here I wait for a socket, for a client socket. I accept it. Then I want to read my client socket. Afterwards, I handle the request. I do something, I don't know what. And then I send the result back to the client. That's a typical client-server communication. Here, that is blocking. I wait until the client comes. I wait until I have the data. I wait until I send the data. And here, it's just co-await, meaning instead of blocking, I have here an waiting, and I could do something else in the meantime. Okay. Now to something which I assume will not be part of C++ 20, meaning 23. I had 2 years ago a conversation with Michael Wong, which is responsible for or chair of this study group, and he said 50-50, but maybe he was too optimistic. Okay, transactional memory. Maybe you know it from the database theory. You have a transaction, something which you invoke, and if it's fine, you publish or commit it. If not, you roll it back and do it once more. That's a transaction. Have a look here. That is kind of a transaction consisting of three statements. They should follow the so-called ACID properties. That means this is atomic, consistent, and isolated. Atomic means it will happen or it will not happen. Consistent means your system is always in a consistent state. Okay? And isolated means you cannot observe something from here in between. It's isolated. Forget about durability. That's the idiom from the database theory, which you cannot apply to software. Okay. You. Transaction. Transactions build a total order. So one transaction after the other, and they synchronize, of course. So synchronize this relation. You can think about them as a kind of one global lock. And that's all. Okay. And that is for me the key point. That is an optimistic approach. Think if you have a critical region, you say here mutex lock, mutex unlock. Meaning, if you enter this critical region, the whole world stands still for this operation because you want to enter it. But the transaction is differently. You just try it out, you remember the initial state, and before you want to commit your change, you check if the initial state is still valid. If not, you do it once more. That's the half here. You have to imagine this part. That's a retry. And here's the rollback. And you do it until you are done, until you are successful. That's the idea of a transaction. We should have transaction in two ways. Synchronized blocks, atomic blocks. Synchronized blocks are not pure transaction. There's no term pure transaction. I made it. Synchronized block means you can even use a non-transaction safe stuff inside a transaction. For example, stutzout. If you write something to stutzout, it cannot be undone. You saw it. But you can do it in a synchronized block. But not in an atomic block. Here only you can only do stuff which is rollbackable. Okay. You can imagine. Here are numbers. Okay. The important number is the 100. Here I used the synchronized block. And big. I want to. Wait a second for the next slide. I want to show you something very important. Okay. Here there's a thread, a vector of threads, 10 of them. Each thread counts from 0 to 10. And I invoke this function inc, which will increment my global variable, which normally would be a data race, of course, but in this case not, because it's synchronized. At the end, I always get the value 100. Quite easy. Okay. And now the important part. Of course, as ever, you can shoot yourself in the foot. But the point is, I increment here e, which is not in a synchronized block, you see? Outside. And the key part is that I often talk in seminars, in classes about data races, and I always say, there is a possibility for data race. We never saw one. Here, there is a data race caught in action. Wait a second. Let's have a look. 20 threads each counts to 10. In total, 200. 199 something is missing. Have a look here. 103, 103. There's a data race. So they actually appear. Even with natural with ints, what was a little bit astonishing for me, but it appears. So that's a data race. Because this stuff here is unsynchronized, I made a big, big mistake. Okay. Now to my last slide. Oh, I was quite fast. I skipped a lot of slides, but I was quite fast. Okay, for join parallelism. I'm relatively sure this will not be part of C++ 20, maybe 23. The idea is quite simple. You have a thread, you fork a few tasks, then you join, that's your synchronization point, fork, join, fork, join. That's the reason for the name. This example is from HPX. HPX, I have time, I can tell you something different. HPX is the library from Hartmut Kaiser. High performance, who knows what X stands for? I don't know it. High performance something. High performance, the key point is, even the parallel STL stuff is available in HPX, so it's a good tool to play with the new features. And here I use the example from Hartmut Kaiser. And what it does is, I have a node and a tree, and I want to process the tree. Here I say define task block. Then I have a task block here available. Then I do a TB run on the left branch, on the right branch, and then the branches come together here. So I have a tree which I want to process, and I create for the left and for the right branch a separate task block. And that is the join, and that is the fork point. Okay. As I mentioned it, I was a little bit fast, but a few additional remarks. If you look extremely carefully, that is the past. For me, that's also the future, but forget about it. That's the past, that's the future. Oh, Opasa. This is multi-threading. Now you know what Opasa means in German. That is multi-threading with C++ 11 and 14. That is the implementation. With C++ 17 and 20, we got an abstraction. That is the stuff for the people who wants to write libraries, wants to write frameworks. That is the stuff the people wants to use if they want to write applications. That is next abstraction. That's the first abstraction, which is quite hard, and that is not so hard. That's more for the application developer. The only exception is maybe G-thread, but forget about G-thread. That's the future, that's the past. And to make it more visually, the Lego bricks are the threads, and that's the great picture, you know? These are parallel STL, task blocks, transactional memory, coroutines, what else? Okay. As you know it, I skipped a lot of stuff. Maybe you are curious about the details. These are the actual proposal. I assume all of them are the current actual one. Just use it and click it, and then you get the proposals. And sometimes you see they are quite dated pipelines. Yeah, you see. Okay. Sorry for being so fast. Maybe my watch is so slow. I have to check it. Oh yeah, I was a little bit too fast. Sorry. Any question to my talk? Because now I'm done. One additional remark. Sorry. Not so fast. If you are interested in the stuff, you can learn German and read it here, or you can do it in English. Now.
I have a question about G-thread.
G-thread, okay. Should I go back?
Yeah, could we stop an example of its usage?
This, I have to make one additional remark to G-thread. It's a paper written by Anthony Williams, Nikolai Sutus, and Herb Sotto. And the point is, you can use it with C++ 17 because it's based on C++ 17, and there's a GitHub project which I used it to let this program run.
Okay, my question is how it's gonna behave if this check in a cycle of interruption is not performed.
So what would happen if?
If it's not done at all, if we
Nick, nothing would happen.
It won't interrupt. It won't receive any signals.
You see, I sent here a signal. No iToken. The point is you send a signal to the iToken here. And if that iToken is not available, and then you have to say what you want to do in case of an interrupt. No, it's totally cooperative.
Okay, I mean behavior of some code that create this thread. Is it going to wait or just detach this thread or something?
Wait a second. I don't get you. Once more, sorry.
Oh, I mean a code that create this thread. This, oh, it's not here. And is it going to join or detach or do something like
that? This here I don't need unjoin because it's a G thread.
Yeah, I mean
that is quite easy. Okay.
I mean in destructor of just thread. If it doesn't terminate, what's going
on? Conceptually, it's kind of the scoped thread from Anthony Williams. It checks just in the destructor, still joinable. If yes, I call a join. The point now I have you. A join call will happen. Not no detach, which would be technically possible, but it's a joining call. Also thread.join or something like that.
What about thread affinity? Is it will be one of the policies of the executors or what?
Sorry, about?
Thread affinity, the ability to handle.
To be honest, there's no idea of thread affinity in the standard, but you can provide your own executors. It's a kind of a framework. So that's a different story. You put your responsibility to someone else.
I've got a question about fork-based parallelism.
Mm?
How can we customize it? For example, can we put our own executor in there and can we say how many tasks we'd like to...
That's a good point, and that is exactly the point why I was extremely worried. That was all baked. And then the discussion started about executors. And now all is gone because all have the concept of execution. And that is, for my point, the main reason why we will get futures with 23, at least. I'm not sure. I think they will also look at the implementation of, I assume, have a look here, that there will be a point to make some customization here by providing your executor. That is, I was totally astonished. The discussion with executors started 28, is quite old. And they had a long discussion, a lot of fights. And I was quite sure that they will never end. But they were quite happy at CppCon 4 weeks ago. And they said, we hope we will get at least half of it into 20 and the rest of it in 23. I was totally astonished.
And what half do they want in the 20?
I assume, does someone record me? I'm not, the point is, what I heard, I think, from Bright Leibach, what's his name? I assume, Bruce, okay. He talked not to me, he talked to someone else. I think they try to do the single stuff, but not the bulk stuff. That was the thing which I heard 5 meters ago, but even in English, you know, so. So don't record me for such stuff.
Please show slide with G-thread usage.
With what?
With G-thread.
G-thread, okay. The first name, as I mentioned, was E-thread, but they changed it to G-thread, which concludes with the thread from Anthony Williams, but anyway. Okay.
No, slide when it's interrupt.
Here we are.
Yes. In the lambda function, interrupt token should be passed by reference or passing by value is correct.
To be honest, I only copied it from the examples from Nikolai. He provided it for the, and that's all.
Thus by value.
Yeah, in this case, it's by value. It's by value.
As in proposal.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
That's the normal by copy, by value discussion. It's additional overload, which will internally be used by this G-thread. If not, it's an I-token without the possibility to interrupt it. Now it has the possibility to be interrupted. Okay. You have the proposal, or?
Thank you very much for your report. Could you please come back to the slide?
Sorry, I don't rest it. Here, sorry.
Could you please come back to the slide with transaction time? Transaction memory.
With what?
Transaction memory, please.
What's more? Transaction memory, okay. Memory, thanks, Ivan.
Okay, my question is very simple. Probably you know, if they are going, I mean this proposal, to have any CPU unit support for this feature or just to be like syntax sugar using by well-known synchronization units like, for example, semaphores or mutexes to guarantee transaction features.
Please repeat once more, and if someone gets it, you should kick in once more.
Okay. So, as far as I understand, this proposal supposed to have something like a data structure and we can, I mean, C++ program may do some operation with this memory unit and guarantee that any operations with the attributes, with fields inside the structure will be atomic. My question is how it may be implemented, by using of special CPU instructions or by using of well-known synchronization units like mutexes, semaphores, and so on.
To be honest, I only talked 3-4 years ago with Michael Wong, which I mentioned already. And only to give you an idea, the proposal is from 2014. Nothing happened in between. The point is, the only stuff I know about the implementation, which Michael Wong said to me, is they want to make it as a hardware solution, and what's not possible in hardware will be done with software. That was the idea, because a few platforms seem to support this stuff on hardware, so there's no need to make it on software happen. That's all I know, sorry. And to be honest, there are a few implementation available, and for me that is quite unbaked. That's old and nothing happened in 4 years. So the point is, Michael Wong said to me, they look for a few implementation to get experience what works, what not works. And until these implementations are not available, they stuck.
Okay, thank you very much.
Could you tell us, please, about your book, Concurrency with Modern C++, what it covers and how to get it?
No, that's not a marketing. Sorry. Oh, of course. It's quite easy. I start with C++ 11 and write all I know about concurrency, about C++ standard. I talk about parallel STL and also about the future. And that's the reason why I have to update it at least each second month, because the future is not fixed. I recognized it, and that's the way. So if you buy it once, you will get lifetime updates. Now, one additional remark. I started with 300 pages, now I'm near to 400, so